You're listening to Anti-War Radio on Chaos 95.9 FM in Austin, Texas. I'm Scott Horton. Tonight, George Bush is to announce the new escalation in the war in Iraq. And on the eve of this announcement, just in the last week, we've seen a high turnover rate of former high-level employees inside the Bush government. Casey and Abizade. Casey's been kicked upstairs. Abizade is retiring early. John Negroponte has moved from National Intelligence Director to number two at the State Department and has been replaced by a guy named John. He goes by Mike McConnell. And to help explain what's going on and why and the wherefore is my good friend Larissa Alexandrovna. She's the managing editor of Raw Story, available at rawstory.com. Welcome to the show, Larissa.
Thanks for having me, Scott.
Well, I'm very interested. I know you do the intelligence beat and have a lot of good sources, and I want to know what your people are telling you is behind the move, first of all, of John Negroponte from the National Intelligence Director spot to number two at the State Department.
Well, there's two issues here, and they both have to do with what many experts see as a continuing overreach of the executive branch. The first issue is that Negroponte has been unwilling to expand domestic surveillance, something that Vice President Cheney has been pushing for. And in the position of National Intelligence Director, or rather Director of National Intelligence, Negroponte oversaw 16 departments and was in a position to collect data, but not really in a position of any authority to push back against Cheney. And so he was not comfortable, believe it or not, expanding the domestic surveillance. And so that was one issue. The second issue is related to the national intelligence estimate for Iran. And that an NIE, as it's called, is basically a consensus among all 16 intelligence agencies about any particular topic, in this case, Iran. And the Iran NIE has not been released. It's been sort of sitting there collecting dust. Parts of it were leaked 2 years ago, but the full NIE has not been released, and not to Congress even, or even to oversight committees. And so there is talk of, certainly from my sources, that Negroponte was unwilling to, quote-unquote, cook intelligence or quote-unquote cherry picket in favor of a strike against Iran. In fact, his public statements actually are very contrary to those of the White House. For example, he's more than doubled the White House estimate on how long it would take Iran to be in a position to be ready to produce nuclear weapons. You know, the White House has said everything from 6 months to 3 to 5 years, whereas he said, you know, at the earliest 10 years, and that's just, you know, to begin any sort of real kind of meaningful activity in terms of developing a WMD program. So he's been fairly steady in defying and pushing back against the White House on those two issues. So those two issues are really the reason for his departure, and why he moved the state is something I don't know.
The pension?
I'm sorry?
The pension?
He doesn't need the pension. He really doesn't, and he certainly doesn't need any of this stress. I mean, he's, you know, well-respected by the Reagan conservatives and such. I'm not sure what the reason is. It's possible he's hoping that as the number two at state, he can do more to push back against any sort of action against Iran. That's possible.
Now, why would he be so dead set against war against Iran?
Because he's seen the intelligence.
Well, Dick Cheney presumably has seen the intelligence.
Dick Cheney isn't interested in intelligence. He's interested in regime change.
Now, John Negroponte is known as Death Squad's Negroponte, right? He was the ambassador to Honduras in the 1980s during all the dirty wars in El Salvador and Nicaragua.
Sure, yeah, I mean, that's true. He's also, he was the ambassador to Iraq, too. So that should tell everyone something. When you have someone like Negroponte appear center, how far off the cliff this country has gone, and how far to the right it has shifted. The fact is, he saw the intelligence, and he doesn't believe that there's a threat, nor does he support military action.
Yeah. Well, how far to the crazy it's shifted? I don't know if there's anything really conservative about this policy.
Oh, no, I didn't say conservative. I said far to the right.
Okay.
I'm thinking more, along the lines of corporatism or fascism.
Yeah, militarism.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, militarism.
Well, I mean, the military-industrial complex. Because this isn't, the threat that's being, the threat rhetoric that Iran is this threat and that they're going to, wipe Israel off the face of the earth with nuclear weapons and this and that. Sure, Ahmadinejad, that's the president of Iran, is a nutcase. He hates Israel, sure. But, if we're going to attack people who hate, not even us, but our allies, but let's say who hate us, if that were, for example, the Wahhabists in Saudi Arabia, the citizens there, they hate us. They hate the United States to the point of insanity. Saudi Arabia will not acknowledge Israel as a country. Saudi Arabia funds terrorism, and yet we're not taking them on. Why? Whereas Iran, who is in no position to do anything in terms of an actual attack, and I think, quite honestly, even if they had a nuclear weapon, they wouldn't, because they wouldn't last long.
No, Israel has 400 nukes, and everybody knows it.
Well, I think Israel would manage to fire off one, and then they couldn't sustain a prolonged, military strike. But the point is this. You've got Pakistan, also, who is the number one supporter of terrorism, in my opinion.
And is a military dictatorship.
Exactly. And is the number one proliferator to both to North Korea and to Iran. And yet, they're not a threat. They're our ally. But somehow, Iran is a threat. And to me, using the argument that Ahmadinejad wants to wipe Israel off the face of the earth is really kind of, for me, it's an ethically, dubious argument. I'm a Jew, and I feel like this sort of argument is being played to my worst fears, and that's manipulative. I don't believe Iran is a threat, because, frankly, I've talked to enough people who are experts in this who don't see Iran as a threat. So the real question is, why do we need to attack Iran? And clearly Negroponte was not willing to go along with whatever it was that was on the agenda.
And as you say, he oversaw this NIE that came out that said, between 5 and 10 years, probably more like 10.
Well, he didn't actually, the NIE didn't come out. There were parts of it that were leaked.
Right. And he basically confirmed that much to the reporters. Yeah, about 10 years.
Right. If that. I mean, he's maintained, over and over, he's maintained that Iran is not a threat and that he's advised the president against any activity with regard to Iran, military activity. So, apparently that's not what this administration wanted to hear.
Right. Now, Larissa, is this the same national intelligence estimate that Seymour Hersh reported on in November in his article, The Next Act, where he said that the CIA said, listen, we tried our best, and we can find no evidence whatsoever that they even have a nuclear weapons program at all.
Well, we don't know. We don't have all the information with regard to the NIE to know who contributed what part and who said what exactly.
But this is potentially this. You believe this is that Hirsch was referring to the same NIE that.
Well, no. I mean, Hirsch could have been referring to, you know, the CIA who contributed to the NIE has their own reports that they do on this sort of stuff. And the NIE, then, is based on the reports of all 16 agencies. So whatever it is that Hirsch saw is you know, the CIA report that would have been contributed to the NIE process, and then it's all aggregated and distilled into a single, consensual, like, yes or no, is this
right.
a threat or not a threat type of thing. So what he would have seen would have been, assuming that he actually saw the documents or was told about them, he would have seen the CIA report that would have been sent to the NIE process. But I don't believe he saw the actual NIE.
I see. Now, Scott Ritter, in a joint appearance with Seymour Hirsch at the, I believe, the American Ethical Society
right.
in New York back in September, October, he said that his sources in Israeli intelligence, because, of course, Scott Ritter is... worked with Israeli intelligence back during his days as a UN weapons inspector, and he says
right.
he still has close contacts and friends in Israeli intelligence,
right.
and that they tell him they don't have a shred of evidence either. They're basically politicians are full of hot air on this.
Well, that's the truth. And then you have to ask why it is that all of this bad intelligence that's being touted is still being attributed to Israel. I mean, where is this intelligence coming from? Because the Israeli military is saying, you know, no. They're also leaking their own damn plans because they don't want any part of this. They don't want to engage in this, so they're leaking like crazy. So the question is, where is this intelligence coming from? And in my opinion, I think we need to look toward the House of Saud. I think these are the people playing all sides here, planting the intelligence, funding the various propaganda aspects, and certainly fueling the motives of the vice president. Because I can't imagine where this cooked intelligence would come from and then be pointed to Israel. It makes no sense to me.
Well, there are right-wing crazies, as you say, in both countries. Netanyahu was quoted recently in UPI by Arnaud de Borgrave, or however you say that guy's name, as saying, yeah. Listen, we need a big public relations push, especially centered in America and especially centered on Democrats, to make Americans believe that this is not a partisan issue, that everybody knows we need to bomb Iran.
Right. Well, I mean, again, they're going on the assessment they're getting, but who are they getting them from? You know, some of these guys really believe this. You know?
Well, I mean...
For example, Michael Adeen really believes this. Bill Kristol, I don't know. He could be a show horse.
Yeah, what about Netanyahu, though? You think Netanyahu is mistaken?
I think Netanyahu is completely out of his mind, and I think he believes this, too. It's not the same as...
See, I would have just thought he was a liar.
It's not that simple with him. I would say, like, for example, Richard Perle, for example, knows this is not true. People like, who's another person who's a Likudnik in the Americas?
Wurmser, Hannah, Schulzkin?
Wurmser and Hannah
Edelman.
Would know that this is not true. That's Abrams, those guys. Netanyahu and Ladin and those guys really believe this. They really, at least with Ladin, he really is deathly frightened and believes this. I've tried to myself explain it, here's what, we know, what intelligence folks from all over the place are saying. But he believes what he believes, and he believes it wholeheartedly. Now, but people like Wurmser and Hannah, those guys, to me are the real culprits, because these guys know that it's BS, and somehow they're culling this intelligence from somewhere and stuffing it into the system, and I don't know where they're getting it from. I'm sure there are people who, like Wormser and Hanna and Cheney and Addington, those guys, are also inside Israeli intelligence and government agencies who are also, you know, part and parcel of this problem. But you know, if I were to step out of this moment in history for a minute, and if that was possible, and I could look at the whole scenario, it appears to me that Israel is not going to benefit from this, just like they haven't benefited at all from the war in Iraq.
Well, nor has America benefited.
Well, right. So my question is, what in God's name is going on here?
Maybe they're all KGB, and it's all a big plot to destroy America forever.
Well, that's even fun. You know, I think I told you this before. I had someone actually suggest to me, and I don't believe this, is that that this is in fact a KGB plot to destroy America from within.
Yeah.
But you know, no. I think
it's a Dick Cheney plot to make himself grant himself more power and influence so he can feel better about himself.
Well, in my opinion, I think it has more to do with the dollar and that it's fiat currency and that it has no backing and that
Well, but Larissa, I mean, it does seem that the entire establishment, except for the American Enterprise Institute, at this point are lined up against the policy. It's Bush and Cheney versus the world at this point.
The American Enterprise Institute as a whole. I mean, Norm Ornstein isn't lined up behind this at all.
Even more to the point. So not even everybody at AEI is for it. The Council on Foreign Relations types are clearly not on board for expanding this.
No, I mean, everybody has jumped ship with two exceptions, and I would even say one exception, and that is the corporatists, the people who want a war of aggression for resources, for power, for greed. And then there are a few, you know, kind of scattered folks about this kind of nucleus of corporatists who are really that frightened that, they're wrong, but they really believe this.
Now, which corporatists are we talking about here? Because we see people like James Baker, who is Mr. Texas Oil Man.
Even James Baker thinks, I mean, this is what I'm saying. You've got hardcore fascism when you've got people like James Baker coming out as a hero in trying to, or as the center. He's a corporatist, absolutely, as is Negroponte,
Right, so which ones are still on board?
What I'm saying is the only people that are left are from the corporatist camp. The true neoconservatives have jumped ship. I mean, if you look who's left, it's really like the Trotskyites. About it.
Well, of course. It's been the Trotskyites this whole time, leading everybody else. I mean, even when the American people and the whole establishment climbed on board for the invasion of Iraq, it was all being led by the neocons in the Pentagon and the vice president's office.
Right, but I would hardly classify them as Trotskyites.
They are.
Mussolini, no.
No, they're all former Shockmanites, and Paul Wolfowitz is a former Trotskyite.
Levine is a Trotskyite, that's true, but no, there's no question. Cheney is not a Trotskyite.
Well, I never said Cheney.
Yeah, but Cheney's running the ship here, and Addington, too, and then these guys are, are as far to the right as you're going to get. In my opinion, they've gone, over into the fascist camp at this point. They are so off the rails that people we traditionally think of as far right seem sane in comparison.
Now, who's this guy McConnell?
Oh, God, McConnell. Well, frankly, I hadn't heard of him before until I, started talking to a few folks, and quite a few folks, I should say. And boy, oh boy, there is nobody who supports this nomination. He's supposed to replace Negroponte at the ODNI. And, there's differences as to why they don't support it. Some think of him as incompetent. Some of them think of him as a tool of Cheney's. Actually, most of them do. you know, and some are much more concerned about his ties to domestic surveillance and total information awareness, with good reason. So there's all, you know, there's...
Talk to me a little bit about this good reason to be concerned about his role in total information awareness.
Well, I mean, he actually helped develop the idea of total information awareness with Poindexter. He was also head of the NSA, and if you think about this domestic, or rather national intelligence director position, which is new, it's only 2 years old, you've got a guy coming in from military intelligence to run domestic intelligence. That is very frightening. But aside from just being at the NSA, he was also very involved in information warfare policy making at DIA. He's also, since he's left or retired from the military, he's been the vice president of financial intelligence, if you will, types of products for Booz Allen Hamilton, who's a major defense contractor. And if you remember when the New York Times reported that the Bush administration was engaged in warrantless wiretapping, I almost said wireless wiretapping, warrantless surveillance, they then later reported that, which didn't seem to make as much of a dent, they later reported that the Bush administration was involved with the surveillance of banking records, personal private banking records.
Mm-hmm.
And they were using the CIA to do it, and domestically as well. Now, here's what's interesting. The argument was made that there, by the administration and the CIA, that there were safeguards in place against, you know, violating privacy rights and all of this. And the company that was, yes, a company as opposed to a group of an oversight committee, the company that was handling the auditing and making sure that nobody's rights were violated is Booz Allen Hamilton.
Mm-hmm.
And the department, or rather the arm of Booz Allen Hamilton, is McConnell's arm. So do you see this? There's a serious problem here.
Well, and this is something that's gone back to the 90s too, right? Is the CIA basically using front companies to collect information that they're not allowed to collect?
Well, I mean, there is good reason to track money when you're looking for terrorists, absolutely. But the CIA has traditionally, and until this administration at least, been an agency that's operated outside of the U.S. There have been, on occasion, like Watergate, when certain assets or that belong to the CIA, or in some cases maybe an employee, did some domestic work, but that in general has not been the case. They are an agency that works outside of the country. The fact that they're running a program looking at financial records inside the country with the only oversight, not of elected officials or committees or even, you know, some hastily formed intelligence oversight group of, you know, experts or something. The fact that they're being, that the only oversight they're getting is from a corporate client, I mean, a corporate partner of defense intelligence, and that the person running this is now being appointed to domestic, to head domestic intelligence, all of it, all 16 departments.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is huge. That is beyond anything that we've ever seen in terms of, if you're worried about a police state, this is it. This is where I would say you're going to see the thing develop, the thing grow.
Well, and when I talked to the former CIA analyst Ray McGovern on Monday, he emphasized a point that you made in there as well, that what we're talking about is ultimately a complete military takeover of America's intelligence capability that used to be run by civilians.
Right. Exactly. Because
the difference is a civilian can say, look, boss, this really isn't right, whereas a military guy is supposed to click his heels and say, yes, sir, and that's the end of that.
Well, but here's the beauty of McConnell. He's both. But more importantly, he's a Cheney guy. And he's a guy who has a dubious background and who sees the world through a lens of everyone is a threat, domestic or otherwise, until we've cleared them as not a threat. And he is so extreme and so compromised by his own business dealings and by his own record that what McGovern said to you is literally what I heard from most intel folks, and that is that you are seeing the reason you see intelligence being politicized the way it is because it's not being done by professionals anymore. It's being outsourced, first and foremost is outsourced, not militarized necessarily, but outsourced to private corporations, and it's second to that is being then used by the military for its own purposes. Now, if you're a corporation and you have a contract with the military and you rely on the military for a lot of money, my guess is you're going to do as you're told when you have people placed in government type positions in terms of making sure that that business relationship continues.
And of course, so, that's the name of the game. That's the American way.
Right, but that's the problem. That's, I think, the biggest issue is not the militarization of intelligence, but the privatization of intelligence. There was a conversation I had with Bob Baer, who is a CIA field officer, caseworker, a while back, where, I mean, way, way, way before any of this was an issue, I think even before the NSA stuff, the warrantless wiretapping was revealed, And I said, you know, just kind of off the cuff, what do you think is the biggest issue with the, with the CIA? What's with the intelligence failures in all of this? And, you know, he was fairly clear. Very clear, actually. He said, you know, look, it's privatized. And when you are giving someone profit motivation as opposed to service motivation, in other words, they're not going in to serve. And so they take this oath and they believe in something. They're going in to make a profit.
Sure, it's the worst side of both capitalism and statism because it's tax money, but the profit motive. The costs are all socialized onto the taxpayer, but it's private interests at stake at the end of the day.
Right, and it serves the private interests to create the bad intelligence so they can get more contracts. In other words, they give the client what they want. The client wants bad intelligence. The company wants the money. And you know, I mean, you can really theorize it if from that starting point.
Sure.
All possibilities. You could say that the cooked intelligence could have been cooked in order to provide more contracts because the war would go so badly. I've heard people say that. I've heard people say, you know, the reason the intelligence was so bad is because you had losers and, you know, inexperienced people, people who weren't professionals doing it. You could say that, too. But no matter how you see it, it is a big problem. And, you know, whenever I've pointed this out, I can't believe I've heard this, people have said to me, well, that's because you support you're a supporter of the CIA and all of this, which is absolutely ridiculous. You know, but the reality is the reality. And this is a very dangerous nomination. And if the Democrats confirm him, I'm not sure what will happen next. I mean, you have a person then who can decide FBI matters, CIA matters, Homeland Security matters, what information gets out and to whom about anything. That's a very powerful button to have for the vice president. And that makes, well, most people I talk to, if not all, and me, very nervous. It should make the public very nervous.
All right. Thank you very much for your time today, everybody. Larissa Alexandrovna is the managing editor of Raw Story. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.